going to take me a minute. We're going to get started this evening with our program. Hello, my name is Angela Jaime. I'm the chair of the Shepard Symposium. I want to thank you all for coming out tonight to the 19th annual Shepard Symposium on Social Justice. Excellent. Thank you. Yes. Last night, I think I said that too quick, and everybody's like, oh, yeah, great. 19 years. So next year will be our 20th anniversary, obviously. We're going to have a huge bash, so I'm really looking forward to that. Last night and today, we've had great programs. Dr. Peggy McIntosh came and gave a wonderful speech, had a very great interaction with the audience, and did two workshops for us. We had concurrent sessions all day today. We had an amazing panel hosted by our state representative, Dr. Kathy Connolly. It went very well, talking about marriage equality and some of the things that we need to be thinking about in anti-discrimination laws currently. We have an amazing Friday and Saturday schedule of events. Tomorrow, we have concurrent sessions in the morning. We also have Io Tillett speaking on her project, The Self-Evident Truth. There's a flyer that looks like this out on the registration table, and there's a release form right next to it. If you want to be part of the project, which is, she's taking portraits of people who fall anywhere on the spectrum of affectional orientation, and that these portraits will be displayed in the Washington Monument next summer, and as a statement of, we are you. So I want to invite you to all participate. She'll be doing her TED Talk tomorrow at 12:30. And then she'll also be available all day tomorrow and Saturday to take those photos. We also have tomorrow evening, the Friday Night Fever program is going to sponsor Selma, the movie. So that'll be airing in three different times. The first airing, I think at 5:30 or 6, we'll have a panel included with it to talk about some of the issues within the movie and some of the things that you should think about while you're watching the movie. On Saturday, we are doing concurrent sessions in the morning, and there are a select few sessions that we've chosen to address issues, concerns for GSAs, Gay Straight Alliance students. We have several groups here from Wyoming and Colorado. Just raise your hand if you're from a GSA somewhere in those areas. Excellent. Very good. We want to thank the GSAs for coming. All of our fundraising this year will go towards helping them put on their own programs in their own schools and communities. So help us out with that. We'll be selling books for Jean Kilbourne after the movie, and all of those proceeds will go to that same fund. We have a Saturday night party called the Black and White Affair. There's some flyers on the main table outside. And that is a fundraiser party also for the GSA, but we'll have a DJ, we'll have a raffle, lots of giveaways, lots of really great stuff. We got a couple $50 gift certificates and gift certificates from across town that have been donated for us to raffle off. So please come out. That's from 9 to 1 a.m. in the Civic Center North Gym. And then we have several other flyers out on the registration table. For one is, we've got the story of Harvey Milk that's coming on March 10th, and so that's going to be premiering here on the University of Wyoming campus at 2 o'clock, May 10th, sorry, March, that wouldn't make sense. And then we've got a Summer Institute for Human Rights that's happening this summer, so pick up one of those flyers, and then the Wyoming Democratic Party selling t-shirts, and they've also got internships available, so if you're a student and want to do an internship, please sign up for that. I also want to give our tech people a heads up, or a shout out, basically, because last night for the Peggy McIntosh, we're live streaming all of our sessions that happen in this room. And we've been doing that for about 4 years now, 5 years maybe. And it's been amazing because we've had a lot of people from across the world watching our keynotes, concurrent sessions, that kind of thing. And last night for Peggy McIntosh, we had over 55 people logged into the online site watching Peggy McIntosh. And that was the highest number ever. So I want to give our tech people, an applause for that. We also have been doing massive media blasts across the country with people that we know, people that are hooked into our Facebook, our Twitter, our everything page. And we had over 700 registered for this year, and that's the most ever that we've had registered for the Shepard Symposium. So please give a warm thank you to all of the people that have put the effort into that. I'd also like to invite you, if you have a hearing impairment, that we have interpreters this evening. We have some seats up front. They're gonna stand in front of the podium. So if you have difficulty seeing from this or where you're at, then you can come a little bit closer and then you'd be able to see them here. For the past 5 years, it has been my honor to have worked on the Shepard Symposium with some of the most amazing people here at UW and beyond. Those of you who have served on the committee this past year, please stand and stay standing. Can you do that for me now? Excellent. Most of them are wearing the Be True, the hashtag Be True t-shirts that now everybody wants to purchase. And these t-shirts are about being true to yourself, being true to who you are, and being true to humanity. So we wanted to make sure that we were making that statement. I'd also like to personally thank each of these people standing and those that are not here that are part of the committee to personally thank them for their hard work and their dedication. You've shown this to be the most incredible event so far, and without these individuals standing in front of you now, the Shepherd would not exist. So I'd like you to give them a special thank you. I'd like to also give a special thank you to Fabian Hernandez, who is our graphic art designer and has been doing our poster for the last 3 years. He comes to one of our committee meetings and listens to our chaotic conversation about what we think is important, what we think the world thinks is important, and then he creates these amazing images out of those conversations. And so he's not here tonight, but I really want to make sure that he knows that how wonderful he is and how much we appreciate the work that he does. Our theme this year, social justice in a media-driven world, came about in several of those chaotic conversations in our committee meetings and the conversation surrounding the court decisions in Ferguson, Missouri. The video feeds uploaded for immediate viewing around the country documenting violence against activists, women, and people of color voicing their outrage over social injustices. We live in a world of immediacy. Our conversations this week are intended to push our knowledge and our understanding of social justice in the context of mass media like Facebook, Twitter, online newspapers and magazines, blogs, and more. This week, I challenge you to ask whether a media-driven world serves us well or it hinders us. I challenge you to ask how is social justice issues addressed, discussed, or seen by all in real time. Challenge each other to think outside the box, consider new ideas, and reshape some old. It is customary that we are reminded of what has brought us together for this event each year. In 1996, Omawale Akitunda and Dr. Margaret Cooney from the College of Education started the symposium for the eradication of social inequality. Their mission was to start the dialogue of faculty, staff, students, and the greater community on issues of social justice in the context of education. In 1998, Matthew Shepard was beaten and left for dead on the outskirts of Laramie. Only days later would he pass away as a result of his injuries. The University of Wyoming, Laramie, and the country were outraged this young man had been killed for being himself, for being gay. Matt Shepard is remembered as being not only a UW student, but for being a social activist. In 2002, the Symposium for the Eradication of Social Inequality changed its title to bear his name as a living reminder that life is precious and meaningful. It is in his name that we work every year to build a program and continue the dialogue around issues of inequality, social justice, diversity, and change. The anonymous donor for the Shepard Symposium was a hard worker for the Union Pacific Railroad and invested his money well. He was not a graduate of UW. He was a frugal man and sometimes lived in a small cabin on a piece of land west of Wheatland, Wyoming. He was a fan of film, Morris D, and the Southern Poverty Law Center. His first major gift to the University of Wyoming was an addition to the original Fine Arts Center, which allowed the Department of Theater and Dance to host an annual film festival and to teach acting for the camera. When Matt was murdered, this donor was particularly disturbed by the brutality and the senselessness of the loss. He established the generous gift to the University of Wyoming to endow the symposium in memory of Matt. This donor has since passed, yet we remember to tell his story every year as a thank you to his courage and his compassion. This past week, the university community, Laramie and beyond, has suffered two great losses. It is with a heavy heart that I ask you to think about what life means to each and every one of us, to remember the delicacy of the lives we hold dear and those lives we hold to nurture. I implore you all to reach out to those you see in pain, distraught, and in need of someone to listen. It is our obligation and our nature to care for one another. We must reach out to and show each other we care. The Shepherd Symposium holds the memory of a young man who may have never imagined his life would have made such a massive impact on the lives of others. And yet here we are together tonight showing him he has done just that. I would like to welcome the president of the University of Wyoming to the stage for welcoming remarks. Please welcome Dr. McGinnity.
Thank you, Angela. This is a very exciting gathering. All of you know that. I am particularly excited about it for a couple of personal reasons and a practical reason that I'll get to in a moment. But I have a couple of formal things to say, and that is, first of all, I want to officially welcome all of you on behalf of the University of Wyoming to this wonderful event, which all of you help keep alive, and also the memory of Matthew. It's a remarkable thing, and it's very, very good for the university and for Laramie and for Wyoming on a number of levels. I also want to welcome Dr. Jean Kilbourne, who it turns out we discovered in a brief conversation before I came up here that we have crossed paths a number of times in our former lives without quite realizing it. A couple of places way back east, and also, oddly enough, a place called T-Cross Ranch north of Du Bois, where she and I, actually, we might have been there at the same time once upon a time. But in any case, it's great to have you here, Dr. Kilbourne. I have known of her to some degree over the course of time, never met her before. But the topic that she addresses and began her professional career with took, in my mind, extraordinary courage to do, and I'm really interested in hearing more about that, either while you're up here at the podium or later on. So this is a particularly exciting event for me. I also have good news to report. And because I want to get it exactly right, I'm going to read it from what I have with you. Many of you are here, perhaps most, for, shall we say, social justice, or we might say, to some degree, ideological reasons, philosophical reasons, which are very fine. I'm happy to report or discuss briefly a very, very practical reason for the value of this event, that your symposium. I should take a moment too and echo Angela's comments about the two deaths we have suffered in the last week. These are appalling, and I personally have a very difficult time comprehending how dark the world must have seemed to those two young men, to not be able to see that they were surrounded by people who cared about them and who, if had they had only known, would have wanted to do almost anything to prevent them from doing what they did. But that's too late now. But hopefully this event will make us all more sensitive to that sort of pain that others may be feeling around us, and recognize it sooner, and do what we can to prevent it and to make them believe that they are very valuable and will make a great contribution if they just hang in there. So it's a sad week, but it's a benefit that you all are getting together in this particular week, because it helps all of us a lot. On the positive note, I wanted to mention the Laramie City Council this week, and I'm sure some of you are aware of this, but the Laramie City Council this week gave its initial approval to an ordinance to prohibit discrimination based upon sexual orientation or gender identity or expression. The university supports this measure, as it was approved on first reading from several perspectives, the perspectives of approval, but the practical one I want to speak about is in addition to the philosophical, which is the more important, but the practical reason is it has to do with economic development, the growth of the economy in and around Laramie, southeastern Wyoming, and the employment benefits that can come for the population from that. Local, national, and international businesses have made it clear that for Laramie and Wyoming to prosper, we must send a message of inclusiveness and diversity. With the memory of Matthew Shepard still in the minds of many across the world, it is important for our community to send the message that this ordinance will deliver. We hope the state will follow our city's lead on this topic. I can tell you that from personal experience that this sense of inclusiveness and diversity is absolutely crucial, having spent most of my career in venture capital and related financial activities in the tech sector, both in Boston and on the West Coast. I'm sure you are aware of the diversity that is just essential in companies like Google and Apple and a host of smaller ones. These are the kind of companies that we wish to recruit to Laramie for a variety of reasons, but in particular that they would provide employment for folks like you. So this piece, this inclusiveness and diversity piece, is absolutely essential to have that happen. And the city council is taking lead on this. So again, I want to thank you all for being here, and I will happily step aside and make room for the keynote speaker.
Thank you, President McGinnity. I'd like to introduce Cody Connor, who is one of our committee members. He is going to be introducing Gene Kilbourne. But I first want to say a few words about Cody. He's been in our committee for 5 years now. Did you think I was going to come up here and not say something? Please. I get to grandstand a little bit today. Cody's been an instrumental part of our committee. All of our committee members are so important to what we do. I'm really, and I say this not as a demeaning way, but they are the heart and soul of what we do in the Shepard Symposium. But more often, I do whatever they tell me to. I am their servant, because they are the ones that tell me what's happening in the community, tell me what they want to see, what their friends are saying, what their conversations are about. So whatever they want, I try to make those dreams come true. And for Cody, he came to us about 5 years ago, and pretty new to the whole scene for the Shepherd Symposium. And immediately took hold of our website, which is phenomenal, by the way. And we started Twittering or tweeting or whatever you call it, because I'm not the tech person. So, and then we started live streaming, which has made a huge difference in the way that we see and are being seen throughout the country, throughout the world. There was one year where one of our committee members was in Great Britain. He was watching us real time, that's how much I know. We had over 55 last night. We've had people just pouring in, wanting to see what we're doing in real time. But what's even more incredible is that after these keynotes have happened, they're archived directly onto our website. So with the exception of tonight's, of course, because we've got some contractual issues, but for instance, if you didn't get to see Peggy McIntosh last night, it's already archived on our website. You can go to it, click on it, and you can show it in your class, you can show it to your friends. Any of the sessions that were live streamed, those are all because Cody had a dream and we've made that a reality. So we want to thank Cody. He's unfortunately leaving to my alma mater, Purdue University, or has left, I guess I should say. And I'm kind of bossy in the way that if someone leaves, I always say, oh, no, you have to come back for the Shepherd every year, not just this year, but every year. And so Brody's come back, both the Morris sisters come back or are here, and now Cody, we're losing Athena as well to Arizona State University. She's been an amazing part of our team, our committee. Helping with the live streaming. We couldn't have done it without them. So I just want us to please give him the warmest of thank yous for all the work that he's done, and he's going to introduce his idol.
Hello. Thank you so much for that kind introduction, Angela. I didn't know that was coming, but I would just say being involved in the Shepherd has just meant so much to me during my time here at UW. And working on that committee has really been a labor of love. And I'm so really thrilled to be here tonight to introduce someone who I've looked up to for many, many years. So first I have to ask you, if you have your cell phone, and if you're like me, it's like stuck to your right hand, if you can turn that onto silent mode or off and to not record during this event. I know you want to share this with your friends, but we would ask you not to record. So on to our guest of honor. Jean Kilbourne is an internationally recognized scholar for her groundbreaking work on the image of women in advertising and her critical studies of alcohol and tobacco advertising. Her films, lectures, and television appearances have been seen by millions of people throughout the world. She was named by New York Times Magazine as one of the three most popular speakers on college campuses. She is the author of the award-winning book, Can't Buy My Love, How Advertising Changes the Way We Think and Feel, and So Sexy, So Soon, the new sexualized childhood and what parents can do to protect their kids. The prize-winning films based on her lectures include Killing Us Softly, Spin the Bottle, and Slim Hopes. She's a frequent guest on radio and television programs, including The Today Show and The Oprah Winfrey Show. She has served as an advisor to the Surgeon General and has testified before U.S. Congress, and she holds an honorary position as a senior scholar at Wellesley Centers for Women. She has received many, many awards, including Lecturer of the Year Award from the National Association of Campus Activities, and a more unusual tribute was paid when an all-female rock group in Canada named itself Kilbourne in her honor. Yes. Dr. Kilbourne shared with me yesterday, it was because of this namesake that her 16-year-old daughter was finally impressed with her work. I was first exposed to Dr. Kilbourne's work here at UW as a sophomore, and I know it sounds so cliche to say this, but it really did change my life. In my opinion, no person of our time has done more to improve the image of women in the media, allowing us to expose and explore topics on sexual assault, domestic violence, addiction, sexuality, and not just for women, but for men, for people of color, for gay men, for lesbians, for transgendered people. We're honored to have her here in Wyoming, the state with the highest gender pay disparity in the country, to share her work with this symposium. And I can't think of another person who could speak more powerfully about our theme this year, social justice in a media-driven world. So without further delay, please help me welcome Dr. Jean Kilbourne.
Thank you so much, Cody, for that wonderful introduction. It's wonderful to see so many of you here. Thank you, President McKinney, for being here and for your remarks. And I just want to say, in addition to my gratitude to the committee, which is just fabulous, and the work that people do to put this symposium on, I want to say a special thank you to Angela Jaime, who's done a fabulous job of organizing things. She's been my liaison, and she's been great. We're going to have to keep emailing Angela because, you know, I'll miss you. This is a very important symposium, and I'm very, very honored to be here and to be part of it, and also to be in your beautiful state, where I have spent some time, including at the T-Cross Ranch when my daughter was young, having a terrific time. I'm going to be doing a slide presentation, and I'll be showing slides for about 45 minutes or so, and then there will be some time for questions and some discussion. I'll also be signing books or just over there to talk to people at the end. So I'd be happy to meet you and talk to you. But if you feel later on that you'd like to get some further information, I do have a website with a very extensive resource list on this website. And then there are other ways to reach me, too. So I'd be happy to hear from you if I have any information that might be helpful for you or if you have any suggestions for me. Just as it's difficult to be healthy in a toxic physical environment, if we're breathing poisoned air, for example, or drinking polluted water, so it's difficult to be healthy and to raise healthy children in what I call a toxic cultural environment, an environment that surrounds us with unhealthy images and that constantly sacrifices our health and our sense of well-being for the sake of profit. Tonight, we're going to look at one aspect of this toxic cultural environment, and that is advertising. Now, I focus on advertising in my work for several reasons. For one, I consider it a very powerful educational force in our society. The average American is exposed to over 3,000 ads every single day and will spend 2 years of his or her life watching television commercials, just the commercials. The ads, as you know, are everywhere. Radio, television, newspapers, magazines, the internet, everywhere we look. And recently, marketers have come up with new techniques, new ways to reach us. I did an interview not long ago about this thing where some parents-to-be are auctioning off the right to name their babies after a brand in exchange for a certain amount of money. So we might have this to look forward to, little Exxon going through life permanently scarred because his parents are idiots. But, you know, that's another story. No baby was harmed in this photograph, but researchers have found that babies at the age of 6 months can recognize corporate logos, and that's the age at which they're now starting to target our children, at the age of 6 months. At the same time that there's more advertising than ever before, than ever imagined before, just about everyone in America feels personally exempt from the influence of advertising. So wherever I go, what I hear more than anything else is, "Well, I don't pay attention to ads. I just tune them out. They have no effect on me." Now, I hear this most often from people wearing Abercrombie t-shirts, but that's another story. The ads are often absolute nonsense, but that doesn't mean that the issue is. This is a parody of the Absolute campaign, of course, a spoof that ran in a wonderful little Canadian magazine called Adbusters, and it's meant to educate us about advertising, in this case about alcohol advertising. There's copy on this bottle that I'll read to you. "This superb marketing scheme has been carefully distilled for smoothness. Although no one pays attention to advertising, after 1 year of this campaign, sales soared from 54,000 cases to 2.4 million cases. So that's the impact of 1 year of one campaign for vodka. And all vodka is essentially the same. Certainly all expensive vodka is the same. When people are blindfolded, they cannot pick out their own brand of vodka. In fact, when people are blindfolded, they can rarely pick out their own brand of anything. Cigarettes, beer, soft drinks. The truth is, the stuff is all the same. What they're selling us is image. And that's very obvious with the Absolute campaign. It's very clever, it's very sophisticated, but when you think about it, it doesn't really tell us anything about the product, but it does create a powerful image, and people are willing to spend a lot of extra money to buy that image at the same time they sincerely believe that they're not influenced by advertising. Now, we're not robots, we're not brainwashed, and certainly I'm not saying that we are, but you can't grow up in America, or really pretty much anywhere in the world these days, and not be influenced by advertising. Its influence is quick, it's cumulative, and for the most part, it's subconscious. As the editor-in-chief of Advertising Age, the major publication of the advertising industry, said, only 8% of an ad's message is received by the conscious mind. The rest is worked and reworked deep within the recesses of the brain. So it's not just that we see these images once or twice or even 100 times. They stay with us and we process them over and over again, mostly subconsciously. So one of my goals with my work has always been to bring these subconscious messages out into the open, to make them conscious, because doing that reduces their power and gives the power back to us. Now, I started studying the image of women in advertising in the late 1960s. I was the first person to take this issue seriously. And ideas that were radical at that time are now fairly mainstream. In 1979, I made my first film, Killing Us Softly, which I've remade 3 times since then, most recently as Killing Us Softly 4. How many of you have seen one version or another of Killing Us Softly? Okay, so a lot of you, but not all of you. This is the presentation, excuse me, that Killing Us Softly is based on. So there's a lot of overlap, but there's also, of course, some new material. So I hope it'll be of interest to those of you, even those of you who've seen Killing Us Softly, and those teachers who've seen Killing Us Softly 5,000 times. Ads sell a lot more than products. They sell values, they sell images, they sell concept of love and sexuality, of romance, of success, and perhaps most important, of normalcy. To a great extent, advertising tells us who we are and who we should be. So what does advertising tell us about women? It tells us, as it always has, that what's most important is how we look. So the first thing the advertisers do is surround us with the image of ideal female beauty. We all learn how important it is for a woman to be beautiful and exactly what it takes. Women learn from a very early age that we must spend enormous amounts of time, energy, and above all, money, striving to achieve this ideal and feeling ashamed and guilty when we fail. And failure is inevitable because the ideal is based on absolute flawlessness. She never has any lines or wrinkles. She certainly doesn't have scars or blemishes. Indeed, she has no pores. And the most important aspect of this flawlessness is that it cannot be achieved. No one looks like this, including her. And this is the truth. No one looks like this. The supermodel Cindy Crawford once said, "I wish I looked like Cindy Crawford." She doesn't. She couldn't, because this is a look that's always been based on airbrushing and cosmetics, but these days it's based always on Photoshop. We literally never see the image of a woman considered beautiful that hasn't been Photoshopped to make her absolutely inhumanly perfect. Now, this has been going on for a long time. This was the ad for Pretty Woman years ago, and you may think this is Julia Roberts. Well, it's her head, but it's not her body. Her body wasn't good enough, perhaps not thin enough, to be in this ad, so they simply used another woman's body, a body double, as they did in the film. Whenever she was undressed or partially dressed in the film, that wasn't Julia Roberts, it was somebody else. And this happens, well, it doesn't happen so much anymore, because now, with Photoshop, they can just put someone's head on someone else's body. Photoshop has become infinitely more sophisticated. Photoshop can turn this woman into this woman and then try to make us believe that an anti-aging cream has done this. I don't think so. She's a beautiful woman, but older women are considered attractive only if we stay looking impossibly young. And as a result, we learn to read women's and men's faces entirely differently. So here we have Brad Pitt and Linda Evangelista, former supermodel. They're about the same age, each one in an ad for Chanel, but he gets to be a human being, and she's turned into a cartoon. And we're so used to this that unless we see the woman's face as completely Photoshopped, we see her as unattractive or exhausted. Now, I'm going to show you a Dove commercial that ran several years ago. Some of you may have seen, but I think it makes this point better than just about anything else. It's a little less than a minute. Yeah. So no wonder our perception of beauty is distorted indeed. This is what surrounds us. The image isn't real, it's artificial, it's constructed, it's absolutely impossible. But real women and girls measure ourselves against it every single day. And the research is clear that this affects female self-esteem. How could it not? And it also influences how men feel about the very real women in their lives. When men or young men in research studies are shown lots of photographs of supermodels, they then tend to judge real women much more harshly, not surprisingly. The proliferation of selfies make things even worse as girls compare themselves not only to celebrities but to idealized photos of their peers. Now, men are photoshopped too, of course, but men are always made bigger. Andy Roddick laughed when he saw the bulked up arms in this cover photo and suggested they should be returned to the man they belong to. So it's an impossible ideal for just about everyone, but it's particularly impossible for women of color, who are considered beautiful only insofar as they approximate the white ideal. Light skin, straight hair, Caucasian features, even Beyoncé's skin is often lightened in ads. So the research is clear that this affects self-esteem, and this is the image that surrounds us. We all grow up surrounded by images of women's bodies turned into things, into objects. Here she's become the bottle of Michelob. And this is everywhere, the internet, pornography, video games, everywhere we look, women's bodies turned into things, into objects. So, of course, this affects self-esteem. It also does something even more insidious. It creates a climate in which there's widespread and increasing violence against women. Now, I'm not at all saying that an ad like this directly causes violence. It's not that simple. But it is part of a cultural climate in which women are seen as things, as objects. And turning a human being into a thing is almost always the first step toward justifying violence against that person. It's very difficult. I actually think it's impossible to be violent to someone we consider an equal human being, but it's very easy to abuse a thing. We see this with racism. We see it with homophobia. We see it with terrorism. It's always the same process. The person is dehumanized, seen as an object, and violence then becomes inevitable. And that step is already and constantly taken with women and girls. So the violence, the abuse, is partly the chilling but logical result of this kind of objectification. And again, this is a problem for all women, but particularly women of color, who are often literally shown as animals, dressed in leopard skins, in jungle settings. The real message is not fully human. Women's bodies are dismembered in ads, hacked apart. Just one part of the body is focused on to sell all kinds of products. Now, most often when the body is dismembered, the focus is on breasts, because we are a culture obsessed with breasts, and breasts are used to sell absolutely everything. This says the most dependable fishing line in the world. Women are constantly told we must change our lives by increasing our breast size, and the stakes are high. Does your husband wish you had larger breasts? And if he does, the implication of this ad is very clear. You better change your body, as opposed to changing your husband. 20 years ago or so, we were told to use creams and breast developers that were, of course, completely worthless. In ads like this, I really wanted a fuller bust line for summer. One wonders what she's supposed to do in the fall. And then we were told to wear uplifting bras, such as Wonder Bra. If you've got it, flaunt it. If you don't, create it. So we were supposed to at least create the illusion of having larger breasts. Now imagine if men were supposed to play this game. Wonder Jock, the strap for the bulge you've always wanted. It becomes obviously absurd. These days, of course, we're supposed to have surgery, breast implants, and we can even get that done in our lunch hour. And cosmetic surgery has really rocketing upwards, and particularly things like breast implants, and 91% of all cosmetic surgery procedures are performed on women. But girls get the message very, very early that that their breasts are not okay, that they need to change them. And here's an ad that ran quite a few years ago in many women and teens magazines. Your breasts, and I'll read you the copy, I know you can't see it in the back. Your breasts may be too big, too saggy, too pert, too flat, too full, too far apart, too close together, too A cup, too lopsided, too jiggly, too pale, too padded, too pointy, too pendulous, or just too mosquito bites. But with Depth styling products, at least you can have your hair the way you want it. Now, it is ludicrous, but this ran in teen magazines, and teen magazines target 12-year-old girls. So what the ad is saying to 12-year-olds is, your breasts will never be okay. There is no way, according to this ad, to have acceptable breasts. So our girls are getting the message these days so young that they have to be incredibly thin and beautiful and hot and sexy and that they're going to fail because there is no way to measure up to this kind of impossible artificial ideal. So the research is clear that the self-esteem of girls in America often plummets when they reach adolescence. Girls tend to feel okay about themselves, even fine about themselves when they're 8, 9 years old, but they hit adolescence and they often hit a wall. And certainly part of that wall is this terrible emphasis on physical perfection. Now, men's bodies are rarely dismembered in ads, more than they used to be, but still it tends to come as a shock. This ad ran in Vanity Fair. All of these ads are from the national mainstream media. I don't have to look very far afield. This one ran about 20 years ago, and it was the beginning of this trend of turning men's bodies into sex objects. Before this ad, ads like this were found only in gay men's publications, but Calvin Klein brought this into the mainstream, and now we see more of it. Not nearly to the extent that we do with women, but certainly more than we used to in the past. But when this ad ran 20 years ago, the ad was so shocking that the ad itself got national media coverage. It's a good thing it got some coverage, I suppose. Reporters called me up from all around the country and said, look, they're doing the same thing to men they've always done to women. Well, not quite. They'd be doing the same thing to men they've always done to women if there were copy with this ad that went like this. Your penis may be too small, too droopy, too limp, too lopsided, too narrow, too fat, too pale, too pointy, too blunt, or just 2 inches. But at least you can have a great pair of jeans. It would never happen, nor should it. And believe me, this is not the kind of equality I'm fighting for. I don't want them to do this to men any more than to women. But I think we can learn something from these two ads, one of which did happen, one of which never would. And what they show us very vividly is that men and women inhabit very different worlds. That men basically don't live in a world in which their bodies are routinely criticized, scrutinized, and judged, whereas women and girls do. This doesn't mean there aren't stereotypes that harm men. There are plenty of stereotypes that harm men. But they tend to be less personal, less related to the body. It's all probably summed up by this ad, "Need we say more?" And we all recognize this. We know that when men are young, it matters how they look. But as men grow older in America, that really doesn't matter at all. Then what matters is how much money they have, which is in itself a very difficult, very wounding kind of stereotype, one that can make a lot of men feel like failures. But it is different. We know that rich, unattractive old men can have lots of beautiful young women. That's just a cultural cliche, but it's also true. Whereas for women, it never changes. No matter what else we do, we're judged first and foremost by our looks, our bodies, our clothes, and that just never changes. And all you need to do to see how true that is to look at the coverage of female political candidates and the relentless emphasis on hairstyle and clothing and body type and that sort of thing, which simply just doesn't happen to men. So the stereotypes are different. They wound us all, and they certainly don't make for very good relationships, but they are different. Women are judged first and foremost by how we look. Girls get the message very young. This was an ad in a teen magazine that says, he said the first thing he noticed was your great personality. He lied. So they're told that it's not ever going to be your great personality, it's going to be how you look in jeans. And we all get the message that women are acceptable only if we're young, thin, white, or at least light-skinned, perfectly groomed and polished, plucked and shaved. And any deviation from this ideal is met with a lot of contempt and hostility, which of course is inevitably waiting for all of us as we age. No one escapes. So no wonder there's such terror of showing any signs of aging at all for women. And this starts so young. This ad says, who knew that by age 15 your skin had already retired? It's just so sad that it's all downhill after 15, don't you think? But the greatest contempt these days is for women who are considered the least bit overweight. And the primary message girls get is the message in this ad at the top. It says, the more you subtract, the more you add. What a horrible message. Now, this is a fashion ad. They're talking about simplicity in fashion, but she's also incredibly thin. And look at her body language. She looks as if she's trying to disappear. And I think this is the message that girls often get when they reach adolescence, that they should disappear. Soon you'll both be taking up less space, that they should literally take up less space, not be too big, too full of themselves. On the deepest level, the obsession with thinness is about cutting girls down to size. Now, I've been talking about this for a long time, and I keep thinking that the models cannot get any thinner. They just can't, but they do. They get thinner and thinner and thinner. This is Ana Carolina Reston, a Brazilian model who died not long ago of anorexia, weighing 88 pounds. The human body cannot get any thinner. And so the fashion industry is turning to Photoshop to create grotesque images like this. If you look at this, you'll see that her head is bigger than her pelvis. This is an anatomical impossibility. And the actual model in this ad, Philippa Hamilton, a British woman who's 5'10 and weighs 115 pounds, was fired for being too fat, and they used Photoshop to create this image. And we're seeing more and more of this because the human body can't get any thinner. They're using virtual bodies. This H&M catalog uses the same body in every single shot. The head is different, color's different, same body. Now, I'm well aware of the fact that obesity is a big problem in our country, but I don't have time to discuss that today. It's a complex problem. There are many factors: genetics, racism, poverty, the amount of time we spend in front of screens, all of that factors into it. But definitely the solution is not to make our girls hate themselves and starve themselves. Now, there's been a myth for a long time that women of color are not affected by these images and don't suffer from eating disorders. That's never been true, and it certainly isn't true now. And increasing numbers of women of color are developing eating disorders, as are increasing numbers of boys and men. It's estimated that from about 10 to 20% of people with eating disorders these days are male. So eating disorders used to be considered white, middle class, et cetera, but they affect women and some men of all races, all ethnic groups, all classes. As the media and advertising become global, the American image of ideal beauty is everywhere, transforming cultural differences. So the model in the commercials throughout the world is young, thin, white, and usually blonde and blue-eyed, no matter what colors and shapes are the people looking on. So American popular culture seems to have the ability to make women anywhere and everywhere feel absolutely terrible about ourselves. But there's more going on here than just an obsession with thinness. Cutting girls down to size also means silencing them. And there are countless ads, especially in teen magazines, of girls with their mouths covered in one way or another, or with copy like this, "Score high on nonverbal skills." So as girls hit adolescence, they get the message that they should express themselves through their makeup and their clothing rather than their thoughts, their ideas, their opinions. The body language of girls remains passive and vulnerable and very different from the body language of boys and men. And this is something that's like an invisible backdrop of our lives. We don't pay conscious attention to it, but I think one way to sort of bring it into consciousness is to show a man in a typically feminine pose. It becomes obviously absurd. Women have been getting the message for quite some time that it's sexy to be like a little girl, and there are countless ads, particularly fashion ads, that show grown women infantilized in one way or another through pose, through the kind of clothing. And the flip side of this is the increasing sexualization of little girls. This little girl is 9, and I've been talking about this for quite a while, too. My most recent book is called So Sexy, So Soon, and it's about the harm that's done by this sexualization of children. But we're seeing more and more of it than ever before. And again, this is in the mainstream media. Very, very young girls presented in very sexy ways. This little girl is 9 also. And this is happening in a culture in which at least 1 in 4 girls and at least 1 in 6 boys are sexually abused during their childhood. Now, images like this don't cause this problem, and I'm certainly not saying that they do, but they create a climate that normalizes these dangerous attitudes towards children. They basically create a climate that normalizes pedophilia and that makes it more likely that people will blame the victim. They will say, "She asked for it. Look at how seductive she is," even though she's only 9 years old or 5 years old. Padded bras and thong panties for 7-year-olds are now sold in major department stores, and the latest product, high heels for babies. Not to leave boys out, there are t-shirts for toddlers that say things like "pimp squad," And some parents are buying these things for their little boys. So boys are sexualized too, but in a very different way. At the same time that we allow our children to be sexualized, we refuse to educate them about sex. The United States is the only developed nation in the world that doesn't teach sex education in the schools, and our children pay a very high price. We have by far the highest rates of teen pregnancy and of sexually transmitted illnesses in the developed world, by far. What people don't realize, people who say we don't want our kids getting sex education, is that our kids are getting sex education. They're getting massive doses of it, but they're getting it from advertising and the popular culture. They're surrounded by graphic sexual messages. Images that used to belong to the world of porn are now everywhere. And again, this is mainstream. This is an ad for jeans, although something seems to be missing. But these are mainstream ads for mainstream products. Lee jeans, American Apparel is one of the worst offenders. And these are everywhere. And here's a Tom Ford ad that ran in Vogue, Harper's Bazaar. You know, these are everywhere. And at the same time that we have these blatant sexual messages, there's no emphasis on relationships or on intimacy. And we have to fight to get any kind of sex education into our schools, let alone honest, accurate sex education. The problem isn't sex. It's the culture's pornographic attitude towards sex. It's the trivialization of sex. And nowhere is sex more trivialized than in advertising, where by definition, it is used to sell everything. Whatever you're giving him tonight, he'll enjoy it more with rice. I don't think I'm particularly naive, but I haven't figured out yet what the hell you do with rice. Maybe it's wild rice. One woman shouted out once, she just hoped it wasn't minute rice. Now, you can argue that sex has been used to sell everything for a long time, and that's absolutely true, but it's far more graphic and pornographic today than ever before. And just to illustrate that, here's an old ad using sex to sell food, and here's a current one. It'll blow your mind away, Burger King, the Super 7-incher. Now, people sometimes accuse me of reading too much into these ads. I don't think I'm reading too much into this, but I'll leave that up to you. I don't think I'm reading too much into this one either. Your one-way ticket to Pleasure Town. So the link between sex and food is something we see over and over again, and here's a commercial to illustrate that. Thanks. I love Texas in the springtime.
I love Texas in the fall. With smoked brisket, mesquite barbecue sauce, and jalapeno straws.
You missed a spot.
Everyone wants a taste of Texas. Introducing the Texas Barbecue Thick Burger. New at Carl's Jr. and Hardee's.
So this is everywhere, and you know, we're surrounded by it. And I actually think that the ultimate impact of all these sexual images is profoundly anti-erotic. And I think that the truth is that sex is both more important and less important than our culture makes it out to be. It's more important in that at its best it has meaning and mystery and emotional power. And it's less important in that it is by no means the only important aspect of love or life or relationships. But a visitor from another planet who looked at our popular culture would have to come to two conclusions. The first is that sex is the only thing that's really important. But the second is that sex and sexuality belong only to the young and beautiful. If you're not young and perfect looking in our popular culture, you have no sexuality. It is completely erased. So I think the definition of sexy excludes just about everybody, the imperfect, the disabled, the middle-aged, and older, particularly for women. And this is why I think it's profoundly anti-erotic, because it makes most people feel less desirable. How sexy can a woman feel if she hates her body? And I don't think it does wonders for men either. Sex in advertising is also relentlessly heterosexist. Gay men barely exist outside of publications targeting them. And the portrayal of lesbians almost always comes straight from the world of porn. It's two beautiful women titillating each other while waiting for the man to arrive. Now, the internet has given everyone easy access to pornography, so porn these days is not only accessible, it's inescapable. In the old days, you actually had to go to adult bookstores in seedy parts of town, but that certainly doesn't happen. Today, 12% of all websites are porn sites, and 25% of all search engine requests are for pornography. And most porn online is brutal, violent, and misogynistic. And as porn, and it has to become more and more violent all the time, because as people become desensitized to it, it has to become more extreme. And this isn't my opinion. There's all kinds of research that has been done on the extent to which porn becomes more brutal and more violent as time goes by. And as it becomes more available and more acceptable, the language and the images of porn become mainstream. And young celebrities emulate the porn stars. I mean, we're all sickeningly familiar with this image, but these days you can also get your little girl a pole dancing doll. So you can start really early. And girls are encouraged to present themselves as strippers and porn stars, and to send nude photographs of themselves, and to be sexually available while expecting little or nothing in return. Smart may have the brains, but stupid has the balls. And as girls learn from an early age that their sexualized behavior and appearance are often rewarded by society, they learn to sexualize themselves. They learn to see themselves as objects, which is the most damaging thing, when you start seeing yourself as an object. And boys learn to look at girls simply as sexual objects. We're here, they're just, girls are just in a vending machine, and he's just going to take his choice. And so boys are socialized to look at girls in this way. Perhaps the saddest thing is how many girls and young women have been convinced that dressing and acting like porn stars and servicing boys and men without any expectation of mutuality is liberating. They're encouraged to put up with stuff like this. He's got a post-it note on her forehead with the woman's name on it, so that he'll remember, you know, when they wake up. So their girls are encouraged to see this as their own choice, as a declaration of empowerment, to reframe presenting oneself in the most cliched, stereotypical way possible as a kind of liberation. You have the right to remain sexy, but what that means in ads like this is the right to be an object, to be passive, and to have one's sexuality defined in a rigid, shallow, limiting, and cliched way. When the culture offers girls and women only one way to be sexy, it can hardly be considered an authentic choice to choose it. Now, obviously, there's nothing wrong with people wanting to be attractive and sexy. Just about everyone wants this. But this is emphasized for girls at incredibly young ages, to the exclusion of other important qualities and aspects, so that being hot becomes the most important measure of success. And these images cause real harm to real girls. The American Psychological Association did a report not long ago, and you can get it through my website, that found that girls exposed to sexualized images from a young age are more prone to depression, eating disorders, and low self-esteem. So the images may be trivial, but the consequences aren't. And in spite of all the graphic sexual messages in the media that urge girls and young women to be hot and to be sexy, there's still a powerful double standard with very different rules and consequences for females and males, as you all know. Girls still get labeled. There still are ads like this: tastes great, goes down easy. And girls get the message that they're somehow supposed to be, and this says nothing so sensual was ever so innocent. So we're supposed to be sexy but innocent, experienced but virginal. As many of us know, this is tricky. And it's also insulting, because it's really saying, don't grow up, don't become a mature sexual being, stay like a little girl. Now, females have long been categorized as either virgins or whores, of course, but what's new is that girls today are supposed to embody both within themselves, and that even very little girls are encouraged to look sexy long before they have any real understanding of what that really means. So girls today are put into an impossible double bind. One thing that has changed dramatically in recent years has been the increase in ads that objectify men. Now, again, not to the extent that there are with women, but certainly we see more of this than ever before. And sometimes this is misinterpreted as a kind of perverse equality. Oh, well, everybody's objectified. Of course, it's not a good thing for any human being to be objectified, but there's a world of difference when men are objectified than when women are. When men are objectified, they're made bigger, more powerful, stronger. Women, it's always the opposite. We're smaller, frailer, less powerful. But more important, men don't live in a world in which there are real consequences as a result of this kind of objectification. Men don't live in a world in which they are likely to be raped or harassed or beaten, or at least straight white men don't live in such a world. Whereas for women, whenever there is objectification, there is always danger. There's always the threat of sexual violence and intimidation. And women live in a world defined by this threat, whereas men do not. A more serious problem for men, I think, is that masculinity is so often linked with violence. Here we have a gang rape used to sell jeans, and the woman is the victim, but the men, of course, are the perpetrators. And boys grow up in a world in which men are constantly shown as brutal, as violent, as perpetrators of violence, particularly against women. And boys are encouraged to be tough and insensitive, starting at a very early age. This says, "You talking to me?" And this is a joke, of course, but this is also a baby. And certainly boys get the message that they're supposed to start being tough at a very, very early age, and to have a veneer of not communicating. And we see this, boys get this message, they're supposed to be invulnerable, not express their feelings. And this does tremendous harm to boys and to men, psychological harm and even physical harm. So the image of men is certainly distorted too, but in a very different way from the image of women. But the negative and distorted image of women deeply affects not only how men feel about women, but how men feel about everything that gets labeled feminine in themselves. You're looking at my feminine side, and of course he's talking about the girly tattoo. But this ad, which is a cigarette ad, is aimed at teenage boys. And what it's saying basically to these boys is, you better not have a feminine side. There better not be anything about you that can be in the least bit considered feminine. So it's expressing not only contempt for women, but contempt for all things considered feminine. And human qualities, qualities that we all need, that we all share, that we all have the potential to develop, get divided up and polarized, and then are labeled, so masculine and feminine, and the feminine is consistently devalued. And by that I mean qualities like compassion, cooperation, nurturance, empathy, intuition, sensitivity. We may give lip service to these qualities, but they have very low priority in our society, and men are still very rigidly socialized to repress these human qualities in themselves at enormous cost to all of us. And I feel that this contempt for the feminine affects every aspect of our lives, from our sexual behavior to our political priorities, everything. And we desperately need human beings who share the whole range of human qualities. We need women and men who can be within each of us, both strong and gentle, logical and intuitive, powerful and nurturant. And we all lose, and we lose very badly, when we're told that one sex can have only one set of human qualities and one sex only the other. Obviously, this dehumanizes all of us, men as well as women. Advertising is one powerful force that keeps us trapped in very rigid roles and in very crippling definitions of femininity and masculinity. Now, it's one of many, and I'm certainly not saying that advertising is solely to blame for all of this. Sexism and stereotypes exist in every aspect of our culture. We get these messages from everywhere, from birth. And here we have two, you know, onesies. The little girl is saying, "I only date heroes," and for the boy, it's "future man of steel." So it starts immediately. So these definitions of femininity and masculinity inevitably lead to violence. When you have a brutal definition of masculinity, a passive definition of femininity, and we see a lot of this, of course, throughout the popular culture as well. There's been a trend in recent years that I call the romantic stranger, and in these ads, the woman is outdoors alone, there's a shadowy figure lurking in the background, and always the idea is that a romance is about to take place. Let the adventure begin, this says. I think I speak for most women here when I say that when I'm outdoors alone and there's a shadowy figure lurking in the background, romance is the last thing on my mind. But we constantly get this message, which trivializes the really important issue of violence against women, and it also eroticizes it. And when you link sex and violence, as we do so often in our culture, that's a particularly lethal combination. But we see so much of that. Wear it out and make it scream. This could be a seduction, but it could as easily be an assault, and it's certainly unnerving when you can't tell the difference. There's more of this than ever before, as there are more ads that imply that women want to be forced to have sex. This was an ad for a perfume called Fetish that ran in teen magazines, and the copy says, "Apply generously to your neck so he can smell the scent as you shake your head no." So the ad is pretty clearly saying that girls don't mean it when they say no, and also that boys are like animals, that they can't control themselves once they smell the scent. And there's a lot of ads that imply that, that really are, really, when you think about it, pretty insulting to men. And here's, Axe is one of the worst offenders, so here's one of their commercials.
The world is facing one of the biggest crises in the history of history. Girls are getting hotter and hotter. This is causing guys to lose their cool. It's happening everywhere. That's why the people at Axe have developed a new Axe Chill collection. It helps guys keep their cool before it's too late. Girls are getting hotter. Keep your cool with the new Chill collection from Axe.
So men are uncontrollable, it's all girls' fault. It's, you know, we get this message all the time. Some ads normalize and trivialize battering, and battering is the single greatest cause of injury to women in America. More women are injured every year by being beaten by the men they live with than by all rapes and muggings and car crashes combined. Now, this is a terrible fact for all of us, but until we face it, we're not going to be able to do anything about it. The truth is that most men are not violent. Overwhelmingly, most men are not violent, but many men are afraid to challenge other men, or afraid to support women, or afraid to speak out against this epidemic of violence against women. And I have tremendous admiration for those men who do. But we do have this normalization of violence that takes place all the time. And again, these ads don't cause violence, but they create a climate in which it's seen as somehow more normal, more acceptable. Some ads even seem to depict murder. And these are ads, again, for high-end products, Jimmy Choo shoes, and about a third of all the women who are murdered in our country are killed by their husbands or their male partners. There's also, of course, widespread violence in music videos and films and slasher films and video games. So what can we do about all of this? Well, the first step is to become aware of it, to pay attention, to make it conscious, and to realize that these issues affect all of us, that these are public health issues, that the obsession with thinness is a public health issue, obesity is a public health issue, violence against women is a public health issue, and they affect us all, whether we're the literal victims or not. And public health issues can only be solved by changing the environment. And that means citizen activism, it means education, discussion, teaching media literacy in our schools, working together to change the norms. It means symposiums like this that are so important to bring these issues out into the open, to discuss them, to give people lots of opportunities to learn about this. People often ask me what gives me hope, given how long I've been doing this and how little has changed. One of the things that gives me hope is that I'm certainly no longer alone, and there are tons of books and articles and films and all sorts of resources that are, you'll see on my resource list if you go there. I feel hopeful because so many young people, young men as well as young women, are involved. This is a young woman named Julia Bloom who at the age of 14 launched a petition against photoshopped images in 17 magazine, and she succeeded. She got a huge number of petitions, and 17 reduced the number of photoshopped images. So this generation gives me hope. And some things have happened recently in the popular culture that are quite amazing. Celebrities embracing feminism and defining it in the ways that makes people understand what it is, that it's believing in the social, political, and economic equality of the state of the sexes. And I'm hopeful because there have been some signs of progress around the world, some things I wouldn't have believed possible when I started out. I showed Killing Us Softly 4 at Parliament in London a couple of years ago, and the member of Parliament who invited me has launched a campaign on these issues that includes labeling Photoshop models, requiring that models be above a certain body mass index, and teaching media literacy in the schools. And changes like this are happening around the world. We need to find ways to disrupt the stories that advertising tells us about ourselves and about our relationships. Counter-advertising is one way to fight back. And recently, there have been some strikingly positive commercials, so I'm just going to show you a couple of them now.
Who's my pretty girl? Sammy, sweetie, don't get your dress dirty.
Sam, honey, you don't want to mess with that. Let's put him down.
Samantha, this product has gotten out of control.
Whoa, hey, careful with that. Why don't you hand that to your brother?
Our words can have a huge impact. Isn't it time we told her she's pretty brilliant too? Encourage her love of science and technology and inspire her to change the world.
And here's another one that was in play during the Super Bowl, so it got quite a lot of attention, but if you haven't seen it, this is...
Hi, Erin.
Hi.
Okay, so I'm gonna just give you some actions to do. I just do the first thing that comes to mind. Show me what it looks like to run like a girl.
My hair. Oh, God.
Show me what it looks like to fight like a girl. Now throw like a girl.
Aw. My name is Dakota, and I'm 10 years old.
Show me what it looks like to run like a girl. Throw like a girl. Fight like a girl. What does it mean to you when I say run like a girl?
It means run fast as you can.
So do you think you just insulted your sister?
No. I mean, yeah, insulted girls, but not my sister.
Is like a girl a good thing?
Actually, I don't know what it really, if it's a bad thing or a good thing. It sounds like a bad thing. It sounds like you're trying to humiliate someone.
So when they're in that vulnerable time between 10 and 12, how do you think it affects them when somebody uses like a girl as an insult?
I think it definitely drops their self-confidence and really puts them down, because during that time they're already trying to figure themselves out. And when somebody says you hit like a girl, it's like, well, what does that mean? Because they think they're a strong person. It's kind of like telling them that they're weak and they're not as good as them.
And what advice do you have to young girls who are told they run like a girl, kick like a girl, hit like a girl, swing like a girl?
Keep doing it, because it's working. If somebody else says that running like a girl or kicking like a girl or shooting like a girl is something that you shouldn't be doing, that's their problem. Because if you're still scoring and you're still getting to the ball on time and you're still being first, you're doing it right. It doesn't matter what they say. I mean, yes, I kick like a girl and I swim like a girl and I walk like a girl and I wake up in the morning like a girl, because I am a girl. And that's not something that I should be ashamed of. So I'm going to do it anyway. That's what they should do.
If I asked you to run like a girl now, would you do it differently?
I would run like myself.
Would you like a chance to redo it?
Yeah.
Why can't run like a girl also mean win the race?
Now, one might ask, what does this have to do with a maxi pad? But sort of doesn't matter. None of these are perfect, but nonetheless, I mean, just to see something that breaks through that clutter and it does something different, especially to have something like this run during the Super Bowl, was quite amazing. There's been a series of counter-ads made recently to address the issue of sexual assault, on particularly on college campuses, which, as you know, is a huge issue that's been getting some attention. So let me just show you one more counter-ad that is about that. I'm going to skip one here first, and then.
We have a big problem, and we need your help. It's happening on college campuses, at bars, at parties, even in high schools.
It's happening to our sisters and our daughters.
Our wives and our friends.
It's called sexual assault, and it has to stop.
We have to stop it. So listen up.
If she doesn't consent, or if she can't consent, it's rape. It's assault.
It's a crime. It's wrong.
If I saw it happening, I was taught you have to do something about it.
If I saw it happening, I speak up.
If I saw it happening, I'd never blame her. I'd help her.
Because I don't want to be a part of the problem.
I want to be a part of the solution.
We need all of you to be part of the solution. This is about respect. It's about responsibility.
It's up to all of us to put an end to sexual assault. And that starts with you.
Because one is too many.
So there's a whole movement now going on called the Bystander Intervention Movement to get everyone, but men in particular, involved in helping to stop this. And that doesn't mean interrupting the actual, it means interrupting things way back. I mean, the sexist comments, the jokes, all of that, because all of this can make a huge difference in changing the climate and changing the environment. So it's important to applaud the positive images and to protest the damaging ones, but most important is to get involved in whatever way moves us to change not just the ads, but these attitudes that run so deep in our culture and that affect each one of us so deeply, whether we're conscious of it or not. The changes will have to be profound and global, and they'll depend upon an aware, active, and educated public, people who think of themselves primarily as citizens rather than primarily as consumers. It can be frightening to speak out and to stand up in this way, but as more and more people, men and women, find the courage to do it, the environment will change. And what's at stake for all of us, men and women, boys and girls, is our ability to have authentic and freely chosen lives. As William Faulkner said, I've always loved this quote, "Never be afraid to raise your voice for honesty and truth and compassion against injustice and lying and greed. If people all over the world, in thousands of rooms like this one, would do this, it would change the earth." Thank you very much. Thank you.
So we're going to take about 10 minutes for question and answer.
Thank you. Thanks. You've been a great audience. It's been a pleasure to be here with you, and we do have just a few minutes for questions. If you have a question, please raise your hand really high, and someone will bring you a microphone. So there's somebody over there. And if you're leaving, please do so really quietly so that we'll be able to hear. There's somebody over there.
Ah, coming.
Okay.
Here I come. Thank you. Luke, where are you?
Thank you.
Okay. Hi.
Hello.
Hi.
Currently at the University of Wyoming, the Arts and Sciences Department has maintained the diversity requirement, but every other department has gotten rid of it. What do you think of that?
I think it's a terrible idea, and that I think it's been really... I learned that when I came here, and I was really stunned to hear it, because it seems to be such a big step backwards at a time when most universities are initiating this if they don't already have it. And I think that what it will do is put students from the University of Wyoming, it'll put you at a real disadvantage, because you're going to be graduating into a world in which, as your president said earlier in his remarks, the diversity is all around us, and it should be, and there's more and more of it. And if people are not educated to be able to deal with it and to understand it and to address it and to welcome it, then it's going to put people at a real disadvantage. So I think that I don't understand the decision. I think it's something that doesn't make very much sense to me. I'm realizing I'm about to leave town, so I can say whatever I want, right? And that I'm hoping that there will be enough, protest against this, that maybe it'll be reconsidered. And I would feel, Peggy McIntosh said yesterday, and I agree with her, that whatever happens, it's going to come around again, because it's going to have to. Because as people realize when they graduate and they go out into the world, that they're at a disadvantage because they didn't have this. And let's face it, it's the people who most need it who will not take it as an elective. It really needs, that's why it needs to be required. And it also needs to be required so that all those people with all those different points of view will be in the classroom together and learn from each other in that way. So, I certainly hope it's something that will be reconsidered. I think it's really a tragedy, really, for the University of Wyoming.
Thank you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. 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 Yes,
hi there.
Hi.
So I actually really enjoyed your talk and took a lot out of it. I do have a question, and I hate to be devil's advocate on this, but my question actually Two parts. One is I totally agree with raising awareness. I think also as responsibility as consumers is not consuming products that promote these messages. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the first thing. But the second thing I'm wondering about, if you could touch on, is advertising brings a lot of revenue to newspapers, magazines, and there's also an element of free speech with what an advertiser can portray. And mm-hmm. so I'm wondering where you would ride that fine line between free speech and our First Amendment mm-hmm. and a responsibility with the advertisers.
Well, the first thing, for your first part about consuming and buying products and everything, I didn't go into detail about that, but I think it's very important that we put our money where our values are and that we understand, you know, the corporations that are making the products, because often we do have a choice about what products we can buy, so that's very important. I haven't said anything that in any way suggests any kind of bans or anything that would limit free speech in any way. However, I'm a free speech, you know, advocate. However, unlike the Supreme Court, I do not think the corporations are people, and I don't think that they should have the same rights as people. And in fact, seeing them as people drowns out our voices as individuals, because they have so much money and so much power that it's just, to say it's not an equal playing field is an incredible understatement. So I think that we as individuals should have basically unlimited free speech with the restrictions that we all know, hate speech and that sort of thing that we know about. But I'm not against some kinds of restrictions on commercial free speech, because I think it's different than our own individual free speech. And as I said, I think commercial free speech can often interfere with our own free speech. So I, for example, would have no trouble with, most developed countries in the world have banned tobacco advertising. And I'm not in favor of bans in general, but I wouldn't have a problem with that. I'm not suggesting we ban the product. I don't think we should do that. But that we know now that this is a product that's very addictive, and that it starts, you know, very young, that if you don't, it's that the advertising is aimed at children, getting them to be addicted to nicotine. And now that we know that, I'm not so sure that we should allow them to just have, you know, free rights, absolute free rights to target our children in that way. But most other products, and I'm much more in favor of people being educated enough to demand better, you know, and again, putting their money where their values are, so that these egregiously sexist campaigns won't work anymore. That's what I would hope to see. But those are good questions. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Have you heard about the campaign to get Rush Limbaugh off the air?
Have I heard of a campaign to get Rush Limbaugh off the air?
Yes, ma'am.
Where do I sign up?
Flush Rush. people are calling advertisers and saying, we won't buy your product because you advertise on this show. And it's working.
Well, I think that's people exercising their own free speech rights, as far as I'm concerned. And they can do it in many different directions, many different ways. And, you know, again, I don't have any... I'm sure there are others who would, you know, want to get the people I like off the air, but and I think that we all have the right to speak up about what we think about these things, and that in fact that's what it means to be a citizen in a democracy, is to speak up and to make your voice be heard. And part of what's happened to us, I think, is that we've been made to feel so powerless in terms of having any real power to bring about change. And that's dangerous for a democracy, for its citizens to feel powerless. So we need to be encouraged to speak up and to make our feelings known. Anyone else have a...
Yeah, the question I had was, your opinion on self-defense as a way to combat sexual attacks and as a way to empower people to defend themselves?
Self-defense?
Yes.
I think it's great for men and women to learn self-defense. Is that what you mean? I mean, just basic, I mean...
Yes, with taking, because I don't think there's enough emphasis put on the need for people to take the time to learn self-defense to protect themselves.
I think that it's both, that's a very good thing to learn, and it's, I know that from people, women I know who've done it, that it can make you feel, you know, much stronger, more empowered, and that sort of thing. But I think it's really important that it never be used as a way to blame the victim, because there are, you can be an absolute expert in self-defense and you can still be sexually assaulted. You can still, you know, that terrible things can still happen to you and it's not your fault, you know. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't all be made to feel as confident and as empowered as possible. You know, I think that's a very good thing for us all to learn. Are we running out of time here now?
Oh, we could take one more question.
That's always dangerous because the last question is always, I hated this and why?
Yes. I promise I'll be nice.
Okay, thank you.
I'm the mom of a young son and daughter, and I just, as a mother, what is the most practical piece of advice you could give parents to protect our kids or to help them to be better consumers of these things?
Okay. I mean, I could be incredibly self-serving and say, buy my book, which is right over there. So sexy, so soon. It's a parent's guide. And it is a parent's guide and it has a lot of ideas. But as a mother myself, I mean, I know how it's incredibly difficult to fight a toxic culture, that's for sure. And I know that I feel, my daughter's 27 now, but when she was growing up, I felt that I was raising her in a culture that was hostile to everything I wanted for her, that I had to fight the cultural messages every step of the way, and it was exhausting. And I watched my, you know, sunny, radiantly confident little girl hit adolescence and her self-esteem, you know, just plummeted. And and it was heartbreaking. And she's good now and she's doing great work and all of that, but it's hard. So I guess I'm saying that I think parenting has never been more difficult. But at the same time, if I had to say one single thing that we need to do as parents is we need to create a safe space for our children where they feel they can ask us anything and where we won't shame them and we won't, we will tell them as best we can, we'll tell them the truth. Or if we feel that we can't for some reason, we'll explain why not, you know, why it's not. And that the thing that helps children the most is having at least one adult in their lives where they can have honest, authentic conversations and feel safe asking important questions. So the single most important thing we can do as parents is to create that space and to honor our children when they're in it. And so that's the one main piece of advice that I would do. And my daughter actually says that her friends are astonished by what she and I talk about, you know, but I just always felt that from the very beginning that I just encouraged her to, you know, to ask questions. And if I felt that I couldn't, you know, answer it or whatever, I would say, let's research this, whatever, you know, but just to create that space and respect them. So thank you so much for having me here. It's been wonderful to be here. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you, Dr. Kilbourne, for your wonderful speech. I'm going to move you off to the side. If you'd like to purchase her book and have it signed, you can do so now. We're going to form the line starting at the table and around the backside.